I've got to do today, and we have this document. So it's just not the rules and regulations. Please don't make any recording of yourself, one for chair, please. Fire alarm. In the event of a fire alarm sound, please make your way to the nearest fire exit and follow the instructions of officers and fire marshals. Send me points across the car park. Not that shooting on a full cold. Somebody set that up. Smoking is not permitted in Merseyside Fire District office buildings. Toilets are located further along the corridor on the opposite side, signs clearly marked in the store. You can't use of these facilities, please respect the conduct of the business and the terms of the room outside. Leaving the meeting, should you be requested to leave the meeting for any reason other reason than emergency, you will be required to switch off any recording that will leave the meeting before you open up. Privacy and confidentiality. Request anyone present to us any items relating to personal, private, confidential or exempt information to ensure that the items are not on display until such time they may be required. Recordings. Inform all present at the scenes of the meeting may be recorded. Request if any observers have any objections to being recorded and offer the opportunity to leave the meeting. Mobile phones equipment, please switch to silent. I am Council Manager, Chair of this meeting, and now declare this meeting open. Okay. The pertinent matters of this meeting, please request apologies. Oh, we have apologies. The other apologies.
I need to apologise, Chair, for not being as near ready.
Except on this occasion only.
Apology noted. Yeah. So it says apology over the receipt from Deputy Chief Fire
Officer.
I gather. Ask for any declaration of interest. Consider any matters of aim to this hence the agenda as it's available from the interest of the petition operation. There are no matters that require the exclusion of the press or the duty to exclusion of the press and information. Minutes considered minutes of the meeting, last meeting on the 2nd of September. Any matters arising from any minutes? I'm going to talk. These are correct records of the past.
Yes, that's a great job.
Now we move to considering agenda items 3 and the recommendation here contained there.
Thanks, Chair. The regular members that attend this committee will be familiar now with the format of the audit report for the consultation and negotiation subcommittee. The report is constructed in such a way that there are a standard agenda almost of updates starting with paragraph 3, which leads in to the items on which I'll update on. So the first area to update on is covered at paragraph 4, which relates to service instructions. Since the last meeting on the 2nd of September, a total of 45 service instructions have undergone consultation and been agreed, and there are 9 service instructions which are currently in the process and are outstanding. So examples there in paragraph 4 of types of service instructions that have been agreed, that shows you some of the breadth of the work that's undertaken as part of the normal business of the joint secretaries. Paragraphs 5 through to 9 provides an update on the employment policies and the NJC conciliation. Members will be aware of the position that was reached prior to the online at the last meeting on the 2nd, and since that time we've had further conciliation meeting, or there's been conciliation meetings in London on the 10th and the 11th of December, where some progress was made. It was agreed that further meetings would take place back in Liverpool, involving the Deputy Chief on behalf of the service and Mark and Kevin on behalf of the Faculty of Junior. Following on from 2 days of productive discussions, an agreement was reached in relation to the employment policies, and that was signed off on the 14th of November. So I think much credit due there to all parties involved to reach that successful resolution. Paragraph 9 just highlights the fact that the FBU were not able to agree to the firefighter health and fitness SI under instruction from national officials, and that relates to the ongoing national disputes. So I'll pick that up at on the last item of update on the when speaking to this report. Needless to say, all of the issues are resolved and will be managed and implemented locally in the way that using the same partnership approach that we did for all of the matters of business. So I think a good outcome there, and certainly my thanks to Phil and to Mark and Kevin for their work in getting us to the point where we could seek a model that we could reach and read. Paragraph 10 through 11 is related to 24-hour shifts, and that was discussed during the most recent round of conciliation of the HR policies, and the agreement was reached that further dialogue would take place within the Joint Secretaries to seek to reach an agreement over the trialling of 24-hour work and also the implementation of whole-time attendance, because members will be well aware the station merger, unfortunately, as well, the outright closure proposals, the mitigation that I've recommended to the authority in regards to those proposals to maintain the numbers of appliances we have, rather than losing the appliances as well as the stations, is to utilise full-time retained crew. And again, to well rehearsed argument, members, and I know that you are familiar with it, but I make no apologies for stating the point again. The reason that we would use whole time retained is because that would utilise whole time firefighters undertaking retained duties to give us a degree of resilience, as opposed to the alternative of having to try to recruit community retained firefighters who, I've made clear on a number of occasions in the past, in my professional view, I do not believe that even if we were able to train retained firefighters up to the same standard as our full-time counterparts, they would never be able to maintain the levels of operational competence with the time that they have available to them in retained contact, from 2 to 3 hours contact time per week. So I think fair to say, Mark, some progress being made in that regard, and also in regards to the operational logic for working 24-hour shifts. And what we also seek to do is to tie that in with self-fostering. So I think we've had some very positive and constructive discussions, and I'm optimistic that will continue, and we're hopeful, I think, Mark, by around mid-December that we should have we may well have a position that we could report back to the authority. Clearly out with this committee, but I would do so through probably by a written update, just to outline the progress that we make in that regard. Clearly, if we are able to reach an agreement, then not only does that give us the ability to maintain the availability of the appliances subject to the merger proposals, and obviously the outright closure through the use of whole time retained, what would also put us in a much better position to do is to maintain whole time appliance availability, which is something that certainly ourselves and the FBU we are as one in our commitment to be able to do that. So I think, not to be overstated, given all of the challenges that we're facing, not least in relation to the national pensions dispute, which is something that just none of us can influence, it's totally outside of our sphere of control, and indeed influence the fact that we're still able to maintain constructive dialogue, and not who's focused on the really important issues, which is the delivery of the servicing on Merseyside, and that is testament to certainly the very strong industrial relations we've got and support, not least through this committee of the Fire and Rescue Authority. So Mayo is definitely working within that point. Moving on to paragraphs 12 and 13, relates to the review of the effectively the move to 12-hour shifts effective from the 1st of January this year. We agreed with the FBU that that would be subject to review after 9 months. That's just slightly being delayed because of other issues that we needed to deal with, but that is something now that is in the process of being addressed today through the Joint Secretaries, and that's details of that within paragraphs 12 and 13. Paragraphs 14 through 16 relates to the move to 12-hour shift generation and fire control. Paragraph 15, it talks specifically about the progress made on accommodating the work-life balance requests. Two requests still outstanding, the rest have been addressed and dealt with to the satisfaction of the individuals involved and service. Paragraph 16 relates to the, ostensibly, as the review of the shift, and the view is that we would encompass the fire control review along with the review of the shift generation for the whole time staff as well. It makes sense to do that. In terms of the national pensions dispute, that's captured in paragraph 17 and 18. Yesterday we received notification from the Farmgate Union of a further 24-hour period of industrial action commencing 0900 hours on the 9th of December through to 0900 hours on the 10th. Members of the committee may be aware that an early day motion has been submitted initially, it was by Hilary Benn, now being supported by, and therefore led by, Ed Miliband, which has, I believe, 236 signatures, Mark, is that right? Which is effectively is praying against the, using the parliamentary procedure to pray against the pension regs as being laid by DCLG. That period, the 40-day period for the regulations being laid in front of Parliament concludes on the 11th of December, which is the reason for the timing of the notification of the industrial action. The FBU's view there is to try to bring this attention, to bring this issue, if you like, to the forefront of attention for Parliament, and with a view to secure the debate, which may then lead to the sort of amendments to the pension proposals as we've seen in the devolved administrations. And as I say, clearly not my place to speak on behalf of the FBU, but that's certainly consistent with the that which has been made public over the course of the last 24 hours. That is, as I understand it, the reason why the FBU were chosen at that time. I think that's fair to say, Mark, isn't it? And it remains to be seen whether or not that our colleagues within DCLG take heed, or whether the opposition is able to secure any movement on behalf of the FBU. Beyond that, once the 11th of December passes, then the regulations effective, as I understand it, and Gemma can correct me if I'm not right here, but then that regulation is laid and forms part of what is the Public Sector Pension Reform Act 2013, which then takes effect on the 1st of April 2015. The point I would make at this juncture is the fact that that may happen in no way changes anything with regards to the FBU's dispute. The FBU are the only people that can call off the dispute. That decision rests with the EC of the Farmgate Union and the FBU membership. So just because the parliamentary procedure may have run its course in relation to the pension regs, that does not in any way mean that the FBU have to, at that point, cease with their dispute. And then it remains to be seen where ultimately this ends up. What I would say is, I'm sure Mark and Kevin will back me up on this, the conduct of all staff thus far during any periods of dispute, I think there's been 46, and I would certainly put 46 on it as of next week, assuming that industrial action goes ahead. The conduct of all staff has been exemplary. The professionalism shown by all staff has been in the highest traditions of the service, and I am very confident that that will continue. But as long as this very unfortunate dispute goes on. In truth, members, there's not a great deal more I can say about that, because I'm afraid none of us have any direct influence over what the DCLG choose to do on this, or as we've seen indeed on probably any other matter in relates to the fire rescue service. That concludes the substantive issues on the update. I'll pause at that point, Chair, to take any questions from the floor.
Yeah, that's sometimes we just deal with a couple of the issues. Sometimes it's more by the outside, and obviously I was aware of this going on. And I would say that we have got four stations for halt, but I'm an absolutely enormous body aware of this stuff on a monthly basis, and I think credit to the HFD and the views I have, my colleagues who oversee all this work. For instance, if you look at VA procedures, service produced an absolutely outstanding document in relation to national change over the VA procedures. So much so that we were able to put it forward from locally from the client agency to our national union, who recognised that it should be used nationally as a template. And that work was done by the service officers, and it was simply an enormous piece of work that went on over 18 months. So I would say sometimes, when we talk to service instruction, you don't see the real amount of work that's going on behind the scenes to produce these documents. As the Chief says, on the employment policies, the MJC consideration, absolutely, it's always, in our view, much, much better on the lead output and the lead introduction of these documents. We wrote to the service last week saying that it can now all be agreed and signed off. Previously, the over the 24 hour work and the whole time maintained. When the service and the quality took a decision moving forward rather than having death by a thousand cuts, to grasp more by the horns and deal with these issues now, so it gives some sort of relative period, and I feel you're very close to a relative period, so relative moving forward. That's what we're seeking to do on all of these issues as well, the 24 hours and the whole time maintained. Get them all together. Get it all sorted out now, so that moving forward, hopefully from the start of next year, a lot of the issues that would have been dripped in over the years and coming to April and June and October next year are all dealt with, to give our staff some stability for the years to come, because I think it's been a rough ride for absolutely everyone in the fire and rescue service, whatever your role and responsibility is in that service. And finally, on the national pensions dispute, I'd just like to reiterate what the Chief said. The last sentence of 17 and paragraph 18, yes, there are points of excellent industrial relations, and we can actually talk about thorny issues without either side becoming defensive about that to produce the best results for our staff. And it is absolutely a business as usual approach locally. Thank you.
curb and ask about what low speed manoeuvres are. My daughter would be very interested in that, actually. We'll come back to that another time, not what the serious question. But you are right, I mentioned this at the national meeting, that during the conduct of this strike period, you know, relationships in Merseyside have been cordial, good. And I think some of the authorities didn't see that picture. So it's not a picture across the country, but we're very grateful for the arrangements that we have here in Merseyside. I think we all recognise that we stand on the very brink of some considerable change. All parties looking at what the future of fire service might be. And I think in the tours that we've been doing around fire stations, we've been trying to say to firefighters and the public as well, that it's not the cheapest way of working, but we think it's the best way of working is to retain that full-time method of operation. If we lose control of our agenda almost overnight, I think we'd be forced into the way of saving money would be to move to retain, then probably a third of the fire stations would go. We don't want that. And I think so working closely with our staff at all levels and the public that we serve to try and put forward the message that we're giving you the safest system of operation, a good speed of response, a good weight of response. And I think, whilst we never mention this point, it's not just the weight of response anymore, it's the training and preparedness of the crews when they get there that makes the difference as well, which I think many other authorities probably leave off the list of priorities. As we move through the general election, we move into a new world, we see what happens with the agenda for us, fire, city regions, combined authorities, PCC options going out of the window. All these are changing. I think we would very much welcome working closely with the representative bodies to try and put forward what we do well and that we want to sell to the whole country as a better way of working.
Next question. Obviously, I've had any comments from my I think it's certainly the time of the committee when we said that we were going to approve these.
respond to hopefully.
Thanks, Chair. It's quite useful to, from an opposition perspective, respond to some of the things that Linda said before about the whole time. I guess we are all three on that. It's clearly no sense in some of the way forward. The other thing is a bit of an observation. I was talking to Mark before the meeting started. I spent 22 years as a Grand Secretary of the trade union, and it's interesting to see how industrial relations seemingly what everybody's saying are in reality at an extremely good level. There's a huge amount of respect on both sides, and that's very welcome to see, because even though I wasn't a member of the higher authority, which I say in its darker years of industrial relations, I certainly read about it and knew about it. And it really is quite important, I think, that in any major organisation, particularly one within public safety, that industrial relations are actually seen as being a hugely important issue. Because with poor industrial relations, you end up with poor service, as far as I'm concerned. So it's very pleasing to hear, through being a member of this committee, that industrial relations are actually flipped over completely, really, haven't they, from working where, basically 3 or 4 years ago, when they were probably pretty directing or something. So, support for whole time operation strategy has been a sensible thing. Comments I've just made, just felt that I ought to make them, based on my previous history. The other thing I wanted to mention is where we're going in terms of the future. If we do end up with expanded city region governance, and clearly the role of the fire authority is going to be very much changed, and the management of the fire authority is going to be very much changed. And I say that for somebody who's got no enthusiasm for city region governance whatsoever. But clearly it is in the minds of politicians in all of the major parties to go down that route, so I think my views are very much in the minority. But the consequence of that could be quite considerable, but we don't know what they are.
It is nice to see the real trade union as an association get on the road. I come on 2003, which is I come in 2003, and this disputes that were all over, and then all of a sudden we leave. It wasn't a matter of sitting down and talking, but more a matter of telling us what to do, like, you know, or we get the green dollars. Used to cost £1,000, wasn't it? That was, I think it was. £1,000, I thought I'm probably going to pay it. That's how bad it was. To see it as it is today, I'm thanks, mate. It's unbelievable, it's changing. I think both sides are going to be appreciating what they do and can't manage it. Dan.
Thanks, Chair. Just to respond to Councillor Hanratty, to confirm all Merseyside MPs are the member for World West have signed the EDA. That includes the Right Honourable Member for South North, who is a member of the coalition.
The Minister's up for a bet, apparently, so it depends if we see what she'll do when it comes to the actual EDA.
Couldn't possibly comment, Councillor.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. What we're going to do now is read the recommendation. Do we all agree with the recommendation? Yes, thank you for the update. I think that now is the conclusion of the agenda. The next meeting is the 24th of March 2015. I seem quite aware of that. I'll catch up on that. I'd like to thank you for all your attention. Wish you safety on your own, and then you can go with you.
Thank you.